I feel like John Oliver, some newscaster right now with my minimal background. Okay, let's get started. So welcome everyone to our first ever virtual open house for SFCC Film. We will be coming to you live from our home and from campus. We're gonna be going over our courses, talking about some new and updated ones, new equipment that we've brought in, updated checkout procedures, and answer any questions you might have. I'm Allison Johnson, co-program head of the film department, and I manage courses in film studies, documentary nonfiction, and post-production. And I'm joined today by Milton Reese, our co-program head of film who manages courses in production and film crew, Ashley Martinez, our wonderful film lab technician, who manages our film cage and equipment and has done an amazing job updating our checkout procedures to keep you all safe. Zoe will also be joining us as well, who is our student worker for the semester. And in addition, we're also gonna have many of our instructors here to talk about their individual courses with you and answer any of your questions you might have about those specific courses. One thing I do wanna bring your attention to is the chat on the right-hand side. This is where you can post your questions or your comments. It is being moderated, so no profanity or derogatory language, or you will be blocked. So to get started, I just kind of wanted to address the current situation that we're all in. At SFCC, we were very honored to have Dr. Gloria Ladson-Billings as our keynote. She really put our current situation in perspective. That we're not just dealing with one pandemic, but multiple pandemics. We have COVID-19, racial inequality, gender inequality, economic inequality, and climate change. All of these pandemics affect our film industry and how we study film. It changes our production practices, how we conduct ourselves, and ultimately the stories we tell. Our faculty and staff have really been working tirelessly throughout the summer, and we are really trying so hard to adapt to these new circumstances and update curriculum to reflect the changing film industry. It's an interesting time, but it's also a very scary one. There's a lot of uncertainty about the future of film, but I truly believe that it's going to be students and filmmakers and people like you who are going to start shaping the new normal. The word industry standard even seems to be fading away. So we've been really working hard to give you all as students and filmmakers the tools and resources to empower you as filmmakers in these unprecedented times. Our classes will be very different, and that's why we're here to talk to you about this. We're going to be addressing diversity and inclusivity. We're embracing mobile filmmaking, and we're adding new safety protocols in our production classes to address COVID-19. In addition to the many changes brought on by COVID-19, we are also very excited to have new leadership at SFCC. Dr. Becky Rowley started with us last year and really helped guide us through the pandemic at the beginning of the spring semester. And starting this new semester, we have a new dean in arts, design, and media arts, Dr. Jim Weisong. He is here with us today. And Jim, I'm gonna ask you, is there anything you would like to say before we continue on?
Well, I appreciate the opportunity. I'm not going to take much of your time. You have many things that are important to deal with. But I do want to echo some of your comments, Allison. This is an interesting time we're in. It's a time that I don't think we're gonna really fully appreciate the impact of until we have a few years between us and in this period. It's gonna irrevocably change education. And that's not always gonna be a bad thing when it comes to some of those changes. There are things that were already happening in education and also in industry and in film. It would have happened anyway over the next probably 5 to 10 years. This is simply accelerated. Let's see. You guys, you're hearing me correctly? Okay, good. I've got an odd error message that popped up. But there are things that are going to happen that would have happened anyway. This is kind of like the situation with regard to World War II, when in that period of time, roughly 5 years, the technology that came out of that war advanced the state of the art in technology, probably 15, 20, 30 years or more. So the thing is, while we're dealing with this problem, is to find ways to deal with it creatively and effectively so we can get through it, but to know that we are going to get through it, and on the other side, there's opportunity. People that are fixated on the here and now and trying to just deal with day-to-day issues are not going to be able to capitalize on that to the degree that those who plan ahead and have a strategic vision and plan in place will be able to. We're going to be that latter group. I've already been talking with Milton, with Allison, and with others about how we can be positioned to really move ahead. A lot of exciting things coming with the Midtown Project. There's a lot of things that are happening just in New Mexico outside of that project that I believe when things improve, even when they just start to improve, you're going to see a lot of things take off. So being ready, being prepared, that's the real order of the day. And having a vision and having a plan. And so look forward to working with all of you. I look forward to the good things that are coming. And as I told Allison and Milton this in the conversation we had a week or so ago, having a robust film program involves a lot of different things. But the one thing that you have here, and I'm looking out my window at the Ortiz Mountains, is my goodness, this is Santa Fe, New Mexico. And if you can't make something happen good here, a place where people want to be, well, then we have to ask some deeper questions. But I think we're going to have some good years ahead of us. We just got a rough spot between now and the next maybe 18 months or so. But I'm looking forward to good things, and I'm happy to be here. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Allison, and thank you for giving me a couple of minutes to share those thoughts. If there's any questions, I'll take that as well.
Thank you so much, Jim. Are there any questions at this point for Jim or myself? I'll let Zoe or Ashley let me know. Otherwise, I will continue moving forward. So we're going to get started today. I kind of want to give you a quick overview. We're going to start with our classes that we're going to be offering, and each individual instructor is going to speak a little bit about their courses, maybe about their online teaching philosophy. And then finally, thank you. Bye, Jim. and then finally, we're going to wrap things up with our new equipment, and not just new equipment, the equipment that will be available to you throughout this semester, and also going over those new checkout procedures. I think a lot of you will be really excited to hear how we're going to be navigating that. Most classes, before we get started, I just want to briefly discuss the different types of classes that you'll be seeing. Most classes are going to be online. We did have some delays as far as the classes right now online on fsct.edu. So that's why we want to make sure we let you know if it's online or not. So most classes will be online. Some will be, and these classes will be starting the week of August 24th. And in order to keep our students safe, sorry, now my notifications are coming on. So in order to keep our students safe, so most of our courses will now be offered online. Some of them may be blended, meaning some of the few classes will meet on campus. And when you are on campus, students will be required to have their temperatures checked, practice social distancing, and to wear a mask per the governor's orders. So many of you might have seen something asynchronous classes, synchronous classes, and blended courses. Asynchronous courses are courses that are self-paced, meaning you don't have to meet weekly with the instructor. Synchronous courses are still going to be online. However, you will be required to meet at that time virtually via your webcam or some kind of conferencing service. And then finally, there is blended, which will be a mix of online and on-ground courses. And each instructor, sorry about that, I have no idea how to get this off. And each instructor is going to be going over how they're going to be handling those courses. So I'm going to go ahead and just share with you the courses that we'll be offering this semester. Okay, so I hope you all can see that. I'll move that over. So first up, we're going to be talking about Introduction to Film Studies and Documentary Production 1. So we're going to have our new instructor, sorry, I'm trying to multitask. So we have a new instructor who just started teaching with us last semester, Jean-Jacques Martineau, who has an MFA in film and has been doing a really wonderful job of redesigning the film studies course and the documentary nonfiction curriculum. So I am now going to go ahead and let you speak. Go ahead, Jean-Jacques, you're on.
Hello, everyone. I'm Jean-Jacques Martineau, and as Allison just said, I'll be teaching Introduction to Film Studies and Documentary Production 1. Thank you so much for the introduction. This last year has been a real pleasure working at SFCC, especially because of this kind of reformulation that we've done with the film studies class, which was a film history and then a film studies course, and now it's all kind of blended into a more organic course. And so the class will be synchronous, which means that we will be meeting every week, while there will also be exercises that we'll be conducting online. Though more importantly, I think that the reason why the class is synchronous and the reason why we'll be meeting on a weekly basis is mostly because the way that I have constructed the course is, it's pretty much the way that it was constructed right before it went, everything went online. Now we're doing it through these media landscapes, which is something that will be very important in the class too. The concept of film history and film studies is something that I really enjoy re-envisioning within the context of the class. By that I mean that students are encouraged to bring their stories as part of the history of cinema itself, and we will be re-envisioning the history of cinema in our kind of roundtable discussions, and obviously I'll bring lectures and information and the history of film, but the idea is that we all kind of participate in this reassessment, let's say, of film history that and ideas within film that have had a place within structures, in power structures and social structures, and you know, and there's a lot to be unpacked that I think that right now it's a very important and crucial time to be doing so. And so that would be with film studies, and basically studying how we can also envision future ideas and future cinematic landscapes, you know, just as the ones that we're sort of experiencing today. By just looking at screens like we are right now, you know, what does this mean for future communication and like the language of cinema, and what is cinematic language, and how has it evolved, and how can we shape it for our own desires or our own histories or her stories, if you want to call it that as well, you know, like so anyhow, that's film studies. If you feel like I'm missing something, maybe the schedule, I have a bit compact.
I think right now, I think you're, oh, you got it. Okay, sorry, yeah. Can you repeat what you just said, Jean-Jacques? I think we just lost you for a minute there.
Oh, I'm also teaching Documentary Production 1. And I should add that none of these classes need any prerequisites, so if you're interested in exploring the realm of like film history, film studies, film criticism, and all this, you can sign up for the class. And with Documentary Production 1, it's the same. So if anyone has interest in telling their own stories, right now it's a really fascinating time to be making documentary. I know that sounds a little bit strange since we're all stuck at home, but I think that our personal histories and our personal stories are just as important as what we find in Netflix and in like mass media. We're all making cinema, whether we realize it or not, by filming with our phones all the time. We're already building films. We're just making it under certain restrictions anyway, so that the documentary production one classes doesn't the students don't need any prerequisites, like I was saying. So like we can like we'll be talking about at the end of this meeting with Ashley. There's equipment and different things that we can use, but there's also just our regular technologies that we have at hand that I would also like to explore in this class on documentary production one, where the way that I really see it is that it's the study of world building, like our own world building, our own language building, and students are encouraged to kind of like share the way that they experience media and the way that they record their day-to-day life, or the way that they want to express the ideas that might be present at that particular moment. And this will all be done in kind of like a workshop environment, round tables, kind of in the same way as film studies, but much more production oriented, much more practical. Just basically discover what it means to create meaning through cinematic forms. And right now it's a really fascinating time in nonfiction and documentary cinema. Some of the most avant-garde ideas in the world of cinema right now are being explored in documentary filmmaking, in building our own communities around filmmaking, and what's the ethical consequences of making films in this particular, in the particular fashions and with the particular technologies that we have at hand. How do we distribute them, our own films? All these are subjects that will kind of like mishmash into this documentary production one class through a series of exercises where everyone will be able to contribute their own ways of making film. That's the way that I really see documentary. I don't think documentary is necessarily a genre. I think documentary is an innate form of expression that we all kind of have. And that's something that will also be discussed in class. What does it really mean to make documentaries in today's media landscape? So it'll also be a synchronous class, like I was saying. So that's something that I just wanted to emphasize. We will be meeting on a weekly basis, and there will be discussions such as the ones that we're having right now through the screen. So yeah, that's I think that's all I needed to say in terms of how the classes are going to be operating and what exactly is going to be touched upon. Obviously, this is very broad stroke, umbrella terms, but we'll get into the nitty gritty in these classes.
Thank you so much, Jean-Jacques. Before we let you go, we're going to check and see if there are any questions for you. And while we're waiting for those questions, one of the things that we've been getting a lot of emails about is the new course that Jean-Jacques designed called Experimental Cinema. It's a new course. Unfortunately, due to COVID, paperwork just kind of took a little bit longer than we had hoped. So this semester, we won't be able to teach it, but we will be teaching Jean-Jacques will be teaching the Experimental Cinema course now in the spring 2021 semester. So you can look forward to that. And if that was something that you were hoping to take this semester, I think Documentary 1 would be a great alternative to that for the time being. So it doesn't look like we have any questions. Oh, go ahead, Jean-Jacques.
Oh, I was just going to say that the intersections between documentary and experimental cinema, I think, are super evident. So if anyone would be interested in kind of like starting to get accustomed to using their own technological prosthetics, let's call it that, you know, cameras and sound recording equipment and all this, in order to get it and start getting used to it, the class will be tailored for that as well, especially knowing that there will be experimental cinema next semester. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Jean-Jacques. And I'm gonna go ahead and share the screen again so we can take a look at some of the classes. So again, if you're just joining us, we just discussed film studies and documentary production one. Those are the days and times. They are online. They are 16-week courses. Neither of them have prereqs. So moving on, we're gonna switch over to Scotty Milder. Scotty Milder has an MFA in screenwriting, and he's actually been teaching online screenwriting courses for quite some time. So Scotty is well versed in online teaching, and also teaches screenwriting online at Seattle Film Institute. So I'm going to go ahead and switch over to you, Scotty.
Hello. Can everyone hear me?
Yep, you're on.
Yeah, so My name is Scotty. I've been the screenwriting instructor at SFCC since probably about 10 years now. I think exactly 10 years, actually. And I was kind of the canary in the coal mine as far as the online teaching went. I was, I think, the first person in the film program to be teaching online. So I've got a lot of experience using Canvas and things like that. So for any of my students, that's definitely something I can kind of help walk you through if anyone's struggling with that. So let me talk about the horror class. So I'll be teaching international horror cinema. This will be the second time I've taught this, but I'm sort of rethinking how I'm approaching the class a little bit given our current times, not just in terms of how we're going to approach it with the online environment, but also what does it mean to be talking about horror films in a time like this, with all the unrest, with COVID, with everything Allison talked about at the start, you know, the three pandemics that we're experiencing. It may seem like a weird time to talk about horror films, maybe seems like a time people maybe wouldn't want to talk about scary things in movies, but it's also the time I've had the most emails from students and prospective students with ideas for horror movies. So clearly it's something that's in the air right now. The way I think about horror films and the way I'm gonna approach it in this class is we talk about the development of the horror genre, both a little bit I talk about the literature side and how that influenced the rising horror films that started kind of at the turn of the 20th century. And then we go through sort of each era and talk about not just the important films, but how they reflected the societies that they come from, the fears and concerns of those societies. So we're gonna talk about German Expressionist film and how that was really a direct result of World War I and also in some ways predicted the rise of fascism in World War II. We're gonna talk about the big bug films of the 1950s and early 1960s. You know, movies like Tarantula, Them, The Beginning of the End, things like that, that really reflected the rise of fears around atomic energy and the nuclear bomb and the changing technology of the mid 20th century. Talk about, you know, the films from the 1970s, movies like The Exorcist, The Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Night of the Living Dead, and how they really reflected the social unrest of that time. And I wanna talk about how those films in some ways reflect the social unrest that we're experiencing now. We'll talk about 80s slasher films, movies like Halloween, A Nightmare on Elm Street, how they reflected fears around changing sexual mores of our culture, the rise of women's liberation in our culture, and how those movies both sort of reflect and also reflect the changes that were happening in society, and also express the anxiety that came around those changes. And then work all the way up to today and talk about what I call horror film in the age of Obama and Trump, specifically how horror films have really started to reflect our concerns around racial justice, racial inequality, social inequality, economic inequality, specifically talking about movies like The Purge series, if anyone has seen those films, and also the film Get Out. And I'd like to leave a little bit of time to discuss kind of where we think horror films may be going now in our current environment. What concerns are we gonna start seeing expressed in cinema coming forward? One example would be it's a TV series, but there's an upcoming adaptation of Stephen King's The Stand, which if anyone knows that story, it's about a global pandemic. So I know this sounds very heavy and academic, but I really hope that this will be a fun class. You're gonna get a chance to watch a lot of movies that you maybe have heard of and never seen. And then talk about what they meant to you. Did you find them scary yourself? Do you understand why, from the time period, they were considered scary? So it's really gonna be a lot of watching films and then discussion. And I'm trying to leave kind of open-ended discussions for people to sort of express their own anxieties about our current culture reflected through the cinema of the day. So that is the horror class. We will be doing, I believe it's one of the synchronous online classes. So we will be having weekly Zoom meetings. And then I'm still figuring out the best way to find a way for you guys to have access to the films without having to pay money for them. So more information on that coming soon. And then, so I'll just talk very briefly about the screenwriting classes. I'm teaching Intro to Screenwriting starting in August, and then Screenwriting 2, which is Advanced Screenwriting, starts in October. The intro class is, it's really tailored to people who have maybe never written a screenplay, never even written a short story, but really want to learn how to tell stories on film. So we start from the basics of, what is the building blocks of a story, all the way up through, the basics of screenplay format, story structure, how to write dialogue, how to think about subtext, things like that. That's a very self-directed course. There will be a lot of reading lessons, some video lessons, and then writing exercises. So show up prepared to write. And then the advanced class takes those lessons from the intro class. And that's your opportunity to start applying them to your own work, your own ideas, rather than me directing you. What I really want people to come away from that advanced course is with at least 2 camera-ready short film scripts that you can turn around and make the next day. And that is a much more heavily workshop-based class where you'll be reading each other's work, you'll be providing critiques on each other's work. But hopefully it's one that you can walk away from really feeling much more confident in your storytelling abilities. So I think that pretty much covers the gamut.
Thank you, Scotty. I'm gonna wait to see if we have any questions. While we're waiting, I wanted to ask you a couple of questions, Scotty. Sure. First, I do wanna echo that I'm very excited about Lovecraft Country. That I believe just premiered. So as a love, so I'm really excited about that. The other thing I wanted to look at is I noticed that your Screenwriting 1 course currently is capped at 15, so it's closed. If students want to take this course who are watching right now and are not signed up, will you be allowing more students in that, or will they have to wait till next semester?
I think I can allow a few more students in. I wouldn't want to go crazy with it, but I've had, I think, up to 18 or 19 in that class, and that's about the level at which where it becomes a little unwieldy. But I'm definitely open to, if there's anyone who's interested, I think we can take a few more people.
Awesome. So waiting to see if we have any other questions. The other question I have that I think is on a lot of people's minds, Scotty, is Halloween going to be canceled? And what are we going to do?
Unfortunately, I think Halloween as we know it probably is canceled. I would not encourage anyone to go to any big Halloween parties. Trick-or-treating seems a little risky this year, but Halloween for me has always been about, this is just an excuse to sit and watch some of my favorite horror movies. So if anyone is interested in spooky films, this class is kind of falling at about the right time to sort of prepare you for Halloween this year. And I always try to provide a list of some of my favorite horror films that we don't actually get to in the class. You'll have more than enough to have a good, scary Halloween season.
Yeah, you can celebrate Halloween every week for 8 weeks.
Exactly.
I am being informed. I just want to go ahead and update that if anybody is interested in adding into Scotty's class that is currently closed to CAP, we'll actually be starting a wait list. So there's going to be a wait list. And then from there, we'll email the right people. But just understand, you may not be in the class yet. You'll be on a wait list because we're going to determine, you know, if we need to open a new section or to add them. There are many things that are up in the air about that. So that's the official stance. But please contact Scotty or me or Peter Tossig or Milton Reese if you have any questions about that. All right. I think that's it. Thank you so much, Scotty. We're going to go ahead. I'm going to share the screen one more time just to remind you all where we're at. So there's some information about the horror cinema and the screenwriting courses, which are self-paced. Next up, we're going to be talking about production classes. So I'm going to flip over to Milton Reese, who's going to talk a little bit about that and how those are going to be updated. Give me 1 minute here. Okay. Thank you, Milton. You are on. Oh, wait, hold on. Sorry. We do have a question for Scotty just coming in. Wait for it. I have the little bubbles that are typing. So I'm going to go ahead, Scotty, I'm going to put you back on.
Okay.
Scotty, what is the homework load for your courses? What's it typically
So in the horror film class, I try to keep the homework load pretty light, so there will be just a few quick quizzes on the films that we talk about. Nothing too heinous, basically just to make sure you're watching the films. And then there's a short paper at the end. And I think I'd have to look back at my syllabus, but I think it's like 2 to 4 page paper, kind of like a book. In the screenwriting class, there are weekly writing exercises. They start very light. You know, the first exercise is basically take a newspaper headline and develop a thumbnail pitch for a story, you know, a couple paragraphs. As the course progresses, we get into writing some short screenplay exercises. They're not every week, particularly as we get later in the term and we get into the screenwriting stuff, I give you a little bit more time. And then there are weekly quizzes in that, as well as a final exam, 16-question final exam. The homework load in the advanced class, the advanced screenwriting class, is you're required to write 3 screenplays, short scripts. 2 of them you must do at least 1 revision of during the course of the semester. The third one is kind of a student choice script. It could be, you know, the first 5 pages of a feature film. It could be, you know, its own short film. Could be a TV pilot, whatever you want. And that one you're not required to have a revision for. And then there's also a few quizzes in that class as well. And in the advanced class, there is more reading that is required because you are required to read and comment on your fellow writers in the classes work as well. Ezra.
Thank you, Scotty. I think that's it for your questions. Thanks again for hopping back on.
No.
And I'm now going to flip over to Milton. Are you ready to go to talk about production classes?
There we go. I am indeed.
Thank you so much, Milton Reese.
Good to see you guys. So yeah, I'm going to talk a little bit about, a little bit about a lot of things. Production classes in general, the safety components that we're going to be building and implementing into these production classes. Also, I'm going to talk a little bit about specific classes, film crew, but Jonathan, who will speak in a moment or two, will speak about film crew one. Film crew two, I will speak of film crew three, also the advanced grip training. And then we will talk a little bit about the workforce development, a new certificate that has been created, the FTT certificate, and I'll explain that in a moment or two. And then also a little bit of information about the Midtown campus, because it's a big mystery. And then the film industry in general and what we're hoping to accomplish with what we're doing here at the college in general. So the first thing I want to mention, several of the production classes will be blended, meaning that they will be partially on ground. They will be partially online. Now, when the classes are on ground, they will be here on campus. And on campus, I want to restate what Allison said earlier on, which is about the screening and the safety and the social distancing that we will be implementing as a requirement. Not only just because we're told to do it, but it's a really good idea to start learning to do that in film production, because that's the wave of the future. And after all, that's what we try to do here, is to teach students the wave of the future. So that being said, when a student comes to campus, they will have to go through screening, temperature being taken. Also, you will have to wear one of these. You'll have to wear a mask 100% of the time you're on campus, as well as in the production classes. You will have to have one, wear gloves. Now, I was hoping it was gonna blow and pop, but so much for props. Anyway, but it's one of those things that students and people getting into the film industry have to get used to. I got a question, this was some months ago, from a student who was really concerned about, should I start taking classes or continue taking classes, as far as he was concerned, in film, because what's the point? And it was like, and I thought about it. And I said, you know, that is a question that I suspect a lot of people are asking themselves. Why should I get into the film industry? It's about social distancing. We can't go on set. Well, actually, you can, and we will. To start, film production isn't going to stop. It's not going anywhere. It's going to change. It's going to evolve dramatically. And it already is. It's because we've been storytellers ever since the dawn of time, ever since we put charcoal to cave walls. We have been telling stories. And film is not going away. Television is not going away. Media is not going away. Again, it does have to change. And so what's been going on in the changing part of it is all the major unions, the Directors Guild of America, the Screen Actors Guild, IATSE, which is the below the line crew positions, and even the Teamsters, they got together some months ago and developed a policy of production, or guidelines for film productions. And it is a zone system where you've got basically three zones of production. You've got your production bubble, and that will always remain, and those people will be tested before production begins, and those, and then they will continue on working and continuously being screened every day, as most facilities are. Then you've got the second production bubble, which is sort of the support mechanism. It's the locations, it's the craft service, the catering, all of that that supports the production bubble. And then you've got the third bubble, which effectively is the outside entities, the production offices, those groups and people that don't actually go on set and interact, but they're still creating the production. So those are how, that's basically how the system is going to be created, at least as of now. It's going to change, I'm sure. So to answer people's questions, should I get into the film industry and start taking film classes? Absolutely. Absolutely. Now is the best time to take classes, to be honest, simply because we have the time. And at Santa Fe Community College, it's affordable. So it's not going to break the bank. Even if you're out of state and taking online classes, our out-of-state tuition is exceedingly affordable. So that's where I think we need to really focus a lot of attention on, to just letting students know it's okay to take classes. It's okay. Now, as far as the ones that meet on ground, we will be practicing social distancing. We will be holding them in our main studio, which is big enough to absolutely have distancing around it. We'll even be holding some classes outside. As I said, masks will be worn, gloves will be worn. All equipment that is being handled by students will be sanitized at before and after. We'll get into that a little bit later in this program. But rest assured that we will be taking and practicing safe sets. We will be implementing safety at all costs, not cost to you, but cost to the department, to the school itself. They will be furnishing equipment, sanitizing equipment, et cetera, have already started actually. So that's basically the production classes and safety protocol that we're gonna be doing. I'd like to turn it over now to Jonathan, if you're ready, to talk a little bit about Film Crew 1, and then I'll pick up with Film Crew 2, Film Crew 3, and the advanced grip training, and a few other little odds and ends. So let's go to Jonathan, if we can.
All right, hello everyone, great to see you all. And I'll just kind of fill in some of the pieces that Milton had already spoke about, so I'll keep my section fairly brief. But for the upcoming fall semester, Film Crew 1 will be the class I'll be teaching, and that is a course that has traditionally been, you know, very hands-on, and obviously, you know, with everything that's been going on this past year, it's been a unique adaptation for everyone. But I just wanted to kind of briefly share my screen. I think that should work kind of normally. Wait, no, I can't. But basically, you know, the Albuquerque Journal, you know, just a couple days ago, had an article about New Mexico getting into pre-production as far as, you know, things starting to move forward. And, you know, while COVID has shut down a lot of what's going on in New Mexico has been, you know, a huge state for film production. And in a lot of ways, it's a great time to just get into, you know, kind of get your foot in the door, because some people might not have that same type of reassurance of, you know, where they can kind of go with their careers. But, you know, film production will absolutely continue to move forward. And, you know, with COVID safe practices and what Milton had talked about on campus, you know, getting that kind of hands-on training when time allows, but at the same time using, you know, the online teaching tools to get everyone up to speed as far as, you know, what you need to know on set, you know, different safety procedures to be kind of working in this new era. And yeah, as far as film production goes, I'll just kind of reference this article real quick here.
Jonathan, I think I have allowed you to share your screen. Is it working yet?
Let me give it a shot. I think that should be it. Yeah, so, you know, even within kind of the current era, I think it was something, you know, over $300 million has been generated with the New Mexico film industry, you know, just within the past fiscal year. So while COVID has certainly put a stop to a lot of productions in New Mexico, you know, students kind of coming in or people looking to have a new career path, you know, now in a lot of ways is a good time, because COVID might have scared off potential people who wanted to get into the industry, but at the same time, there's still a lot of revenue being generated and things are starting to kind of slowly build into pre-production. And with Film Crew, this has always been kind of the introductory class for a lot of people to get a better idea of, you know, what goes into a film production, you know, working in a more collaborative setting. So film, as Milton said, you know, is certainly going to be moving forward. And, you know, as people kind of adjust to the new protocols and kind of new procedures when it comes to sanitization, you know, with community college, we're taking that very seriously, of course, and, you know, looking to having all the equipment sanitized, you know, having sessions, you know, within our large studio at the same time, adapting for outdoor settings to make it as safe for everyone as possible, and really just looking, you know, in this kind of new age to utilize, you know, what's the program has really built, you know, it's a very strong foundation of Film Crew, and, you know, giving students that opportunity to have that hands-on experience, but at the same time making sure everyone's safe and being able to kind of utilize, you know, our current equipment, and which is, you know, a very excellent kind of setup that we have, but, you know, having students kind of be more familiar with kind of the COVID standards these days. So I'll switch back here. So that article didn't look as exciting on the screen share as it did on mine, maybe. But yeah, as far as the as far as, you know, kind of future practices go, it's, you know, going to definitely be a adaptation for a lot, you know, everyone, you know, students as instructors as well, kind of being able to, you know, have that hands-on experience, but at the same time, you know, we'll be utilizing technology. Obviously Zoom would be, you know, kind of our safe meeting setting, but, you know, finding ways, you know, based off the students, you know, comfort level, but also, you know, the practices that will be put into place, you know, kind of in the coming weeks, months with the film industry, and having students get more familiar with those, because definitely, you know, for anyone who might be a little bit of a question mark whether or not, you know, you want to get into film production now, film production is definitely going to be moving forward. I mean, you know, it's a huge industry, and, you know, it's going to be finding the best ways for everyone to kind of work in that setting. So, you know, it's a film crew moving forward, you know, looking forward to anyone interested in the class, and definitely, you know, we'll be pushing forward with all the concepts, ideas, and practices, you know, to be able to work in kind of the COVID era. I think that's about
it. Thank you so much, Jonathan. I think I'm going to see if there are any questions for you before we flip over to Milton, but thank you so much. I think that's something that a lot of students have been curious about, you know, our new courses and film courses, if we're adapting to the new safety protocol. And it's so great that you so quickly have adapted the curriculum to address those needs, so that all of our students will learn, you know, the best practices.
No questions
so far. Should we go ahead and flip over to you, Milton, or was there anything else you wanted to add, Jonathan?
That should be about it on my end. So, of course, Film Crew 1 would be, you know, the introductory course, and, you know, we have several different layers or levels of Film Crew that kind of build upon each one. And so Film Crew 1 being the more introductory class that really kind of covers the basic concepts, and, of course, learning the new practices with COVID-19 and how to do safety on set from there. And then Film Crew 2 would kind of build upon that, as well as Film Crew 3. So I think switching over to Milton now would be a perfect time.
Great, thank you. Milton, you're on.
Hey, actually, I found that article absolutely riveting. It was amazing. I mean, my breath is taken away. It was that exciting. But anyway, so let's talk a little bit about Film Crew 2. Film Crew 2 is really the logistics of filmmaking. And it's a class that I teach. It's a class that is potentially boring, but we do the very best to make it as exciting as that article. No, I'm kidding. To make it as exciting as humanly possible. It's about script breakdown. It's getting the written page onto the screen. How do you do that? And that's sometimes exceedingly challenging, because you need to understand, first off, and it's funny, because Film Crew 2 is one of the latter classes people take. In my opinion, it should be one of the first classes that people take in production, simply because it teaches you what goes into putting any script on the screen, whether it be a 30-second commercial or a mini-series that you're doing in the real world. You have to know scene by scene, shot by shot, what goes into what goes on the screen, what props need, what wardrobe you need, what the size of the crew, what your schedule is, how many hours or how many scenes are you going to shoot in a day, and more importantly, what scenes are you going to shoot in the day one, day two, through day 30. We do all of that in Film Crew 2. It's all about script breakdown, and it culminates in developing a production board, what used to be called a strip board, I think it still is, and a shooting schedule, a day-by-day shooting schedule for a project. It's, I have to restate, I think it's one of the most important classes that production students can take, because it really gets you thinking about how you are going to get your project done. Let's move on to Film Crew 3. Film Crew 3 is actually a twofold class. It's Film Crew 3 and 4, and it's an academic year class. It's sort of our capstone project. Well, not sort of. It is our capstone project for film, for narrative film. And it starts in this fall time with the writing. It's a hefty class. It's currently a 9-credit class. It has 3 faculty members in it: myself, Scotty Milder, who you met a moment ago, and Jesse Walsh, who is not here, but you should meet her because she's really cool. And Scotty teaches the screenwriting component and the developing and development part of it. Jesse teaches the production design portion, and that is effectively getting the look that you want of your film on the screen. And then I teach the logistics and the production, or the producing end of it. And that's really the first that's for that is Film Crew 3. That also we also cast the project, do crowdfunding if that's needed. And it's a really it's an interesting project. It's a lot of fun. It's a lot of hard work. It is a synchronous class, as is Film Crew 2. We meet regularly, but they're both blended classes. And so Film Crew 2 will be meeting in person, but again, so it's practicing social distancing. It will not meet a lot, but there are elements that I think require hands-on. Just it makes it a lot easier. And then Film Crew 3 does have a component, again, most of it is going to be online, dealing with the various production entities. Film Crew 2 is a late starting class. It starts on the second 8 weeks, October, I believe it's 19th or something like that. And then Film Crew 3 is a 16-week course, and it meets starting actually next Tuesday will be the first time it meets. Let's talk a little bit about the advanced grip training. Now, the advanced grip training is a late starting class, second 8 weeks also, October 19th, or the week of the 19th. It's actually a Saturday class, and it meets 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. on Saturdays for 8 consecutive Saturdays. It is a hands-on class to train, to get you used to dealing with all the grip gear that you deal with on set. Whether it be a film, a student film, or when you get out into the working world on feature films, on larger projects, independent films, so you know how to safely handle the big equipment. And luckily, this college has a lot of the big equipment. We have pretty much anything and everything that is used on a major film, we have it. And that'd be lighting, that'd be grip, that's, pretty much you name it, we've got it. So that's one reason why I think students should take classes here if they want to learn the craft of filmmaking as far as below the line goes, because we can teach it and we also have all of the gear to teach it. So you're not getting on set for the first day and muddling your way through, well, what this piece of equipment is. And then if you do that on a bigger film, that first day will also potentially be your last. So you really want to learn the equipment as best as you can, and we can do it here at the college. One thing I want to talk a little bit about before a break is the new certificate that we have implemented. It's called the FTT certificate, which is a Film Technicians Training Certificate. And what it means is it's a short-term certificate. In fact, you can complete the certificate in one semester as by design. And you focus specifically on Film Crew 1, Film Crew 2, the advanced grip or lighting. And it really pushes you into learning the gear below the line. The benefit of that is that when you get that certificate, the local 480, or the local film union, local 480, and they handle all the below the line crafts in New Mexico, except for the camera department, they give 15 days off of the 30 day overflow list, which means that you can enter the union as an active member in half the time. And that means it could go, instead of it taking a year, it can take a matter of a few months. And there's a lot of variables, don't get me wrong, it's not an immediate access, but it gives you an edge. And that's one of the reasons why you might consider starting to take classes now, because if you graduate with a production certificate or an AAS degree, or certainly the FTT certificate, when productions get back into, well, we'll call it full swing, whatever that's going to be, you will then be, you will have an edge in getting into the union and getting work. So now is the perfect time. A little bit about the Midtown area or Midtown campus, or what's also referred to as the old University of Art and Design. We will be working with SFCC Film Department. We'll be working with UNM's Film Department in holding some classes, probably mostly production classes, at the Garson Studios. We will be either giving us or allowing us to use stage C, which is a very, very fairly large sound stage, as well as the equipment room there and some of the labs, plus the surrounding area. That will hopefully start as early as October. There is a chance that that'll happen. More than likely, the reality is probably not until 2021. or spring semester. But that's exciting, really exciting news. It's going to up the game, and it's also going to be working with a lot of different students from UNM's film program that will basically just allow us to, you know, share knowledge, share each other's experience or lack of experience, and gain experience. Basically, that is pretty much what I have to talk about. If I'm not missing anything, we will be talking about the equipment cage a little bit later in the show. So thank you. And if there's any questions, I'll take them now. Or if there's none, I'll run.
I'm gonna check to see if we have any questions, Milton. While I'm waiting, I wanted to ask, or while we're waiting, what I wanted to ask you, Milton, is if someone has taken the Film Crew 1 class before, would you recommend them retaking it because of these new updated policies and procedures and safety guidelines for COVID?
You know, that is absolutely a brilliant question. I didn't even think of that. And that is, yes, they should. Because we're reinventing what that class is. And now is the perfect time to retake it and to up your game, so that you understand what the OSHA certification is going to be. It was, yes, brilliant, brilliant. Thank you. Absolutely.
Thank you, Milton. I'm going to go ahead and share the schedule again. I just like to check in with you all to see where we're at. So the courses that we talked about are Film Crew 1, the lab, and the section taught by Jonathan Mugford. So you can see the schedule there. There are no prereqs to that course, to those courses, but they are co-requisites where you take the lab and the Film Crew 1 course. We have Film Crew 2 starting October 19th. Film Crew 3, Advanced Grip. And next up, let me just pull up over here. So I wanted to briefly go over, because unfortunately Janelle Stafford and Jesse Walsh couldn't make it to this live broadcast today. They're both amazing instructors. Janelle Stafford will be teaching the Cinematography 1 course. Right now it looks like it's on ground, but it's actually going to be an online synchronous course, Mondays 1 to 4:30 p.m. And it's going to be a short-term class, or not short-term, but it's going to be starting the second 8 weeks of the semester, starting October 19th. And with this course, I'm really impressed with what Janelle's been doing to update the course. She will be including mobile filmmaking practices, as well as the traditional cinematography elements that you'll learn in that class. So with that course, you will still be able to check out equipment and learn all the intricacies of working with C100 and other cameras and lenses. So in addition to mobile filmmaking, she will also be teaching the traditional cinematography lessons as well. Next up is Video Production 1 with Jesse Walsh. That's going to be an online only course. It looks like it's still on ground, but it's actually going to be online Wednesdays from 8:30 a.m. to 11:45 a.m. It's a 16-week course with no prerequisites. It's a really nice introductory course if you've never done filmmaking before. Our introduction to digital video production is a great course that has also been updated to mobile filmmaking practices. Jesse also went through Quality Matters training. So she is trained in online instruction, which she worked very hard over the summer. So that course has been adapted to online. I'm going to flip over and see if there are any more questions about the any of the production courses. Okay, so far, no questions. And we are now going to flip over into the post-production courses, starting with Jason Goodyear, who has been teaching audio production classes for decades and has decades more of experience as well. And we're really excited about this course. This is a course that hasn't been taught for about 7 years, so Jason just resurrected it. And it will be a post-production course that is now required in the post-production certificate. So I'm gonna let Jason take it away.
Hi there.
And you're on.
Hey, Jason. Here I am. I'm nice and big. So I'm Jason, and as Allison said, I've been teaching audio production classes at the college for a long time. Still am. I'm teaching a couple audio production classes in the Film and Digital Media Arts department this semester, Audio Production 1, and also Intro to Reason and Live, both of which would be a great idea if you're in the film program. And in fact, the Intro to Sound Design for Film class that I'm teaching, Audio Production 1 is technically a prerequisite for it. Now this is the first time this class is happening again, like Allison said. So I'm gonna be a little lenient on some of the prereq stuff. It really is a requirement that you know what you're doing, and the best way to know what you're doing is obviously to take a class at the Santa Fe Community College. But if you're not in it for a degree, which is a whole different thing, if you're in it for the degree, you gotta do what you need to do. But if you have some background and you can prove it to me and your skills, I'm gonna be willing and able to let some people into the class to make it work and to help grow the class. The class itself is crazy fun. Like Allison said, I taught it a while ago and it went away for a while, but now it's back. Sound for film is such an essential part of film. A former professor here at the community college was the one, Monique Anair, was the one who told me that she had read a study once that said if someone's watching a movie, they'll let 3 to 5 little visual glitches go by. You know, maybe a bad cut, maybe the camera's autofocus, you know, like tweaks a little bit, something like that. But one audio error, one thing that sounds wrong, and instantly you're not in the story anymore. You're sitting in a dark room watching a screen. And so sound is very important for film. And so it's great that the community college has jumped on board with some of the more progressive and important schools in the country and has started emphasizing and requiring an understanding of sound for film in order to get the degree. Basically what we're talking sound for film. Now, film crew covers things on set. You know, this is, as Allison said, a post-production class. So what we're talking about here is, as we've been going through this meeting, we started pre-production, production, post-production. What we're talking about here is the work has been done. It's come to the sound person to do what they need to do. And so we're going to go through some different stems. We're going to do dialogue. We're going to do music, and we're going to do effects. Effects including sound effects and also Foley, being able to do some recorded performance in order to make the movie be what the movie needs to be. The way it's going to work, it is an online class. And it sounds weird sometimes to do some of these classes online. But I can say that over the summer, I did a field recording class. And when somebody said, take your field recording class online, I was like, you're insane. We go on field trips with gear out in the world. How are we gonna do that online? And it was great. Actually, more people signed up this summer than last summer. Everybody had a great experience. Everybody turned in really good work. And it was, I think, partly because they felt like, okay, it's on me now. I get to go out and do this stuff. I get to make this stuff myself. I get to engage in the process myself. The virtual part is the classroom part. And then there's these expectations that you take what you learn and you do something else. You're gonna be supported with materials and access to make sure that you can do what you need to do. But the virtual thing works very well for classes where we cover software. Doing sound for film, you're going to have to work in either Pro Tools, maybe Ableton Live. You could do some things in Premiere. Everybody's got a background that they bring to it, and we can work with sound for film in the platform you're familiar with. So you may have some of this stuff already. You may be new to it, but you know, it, as long as you have a familiarity with the platform, like I say, a familiarity with Pro Tools or Premiere or something like that, this class is really more about the why and the how, you know. And so it is a second level class. So it's more about engaging with the topic as long as you have the ability to do it. So as far as the design of the class goes, we're gonna go through these sort of different stems of sound for film. And so we'll have a class where we discuss the topic. We like watch some samples. We like talk about ways different people did things. Another class frequently with each topic, we'll have a class where we watch a whole movie. That's a great example. And then we'll have a class where we do it, you know? So we'll do some dialogue editing. We'll do some music placement or music composition. And so it'll be kind of like a three-prong sort of thing: talk, watch, and do. And it's the way I did it previously. It works very well for the class, and I'm really looking forward to doing it again. I do want to say one thing in particular about this class as it relates to film in a larger sense and how it like connects to things outside of it. One of the things about sound for film is that if you can do this, these skills apply in lots of different places and lots of different ways. So if you're sitting there thinking, okay, so I'll do sound for film, and then, you know, how am I going to get paid? What am I going to do? Well, a lot of times sound editors, sound mixers, sound effects people, you know, they're freelancers. And so you might work on a big production, you might get a job at a studio, but plenty of people, they work for smaller productions. You know, they may work for somebody who does short documentaries. They may work for somebody who produces commercials. I mean, there's lots of places where the special skills that you gain from taking a sound design for film class are applicable to sort of help you down whatever career path you choose to follow. And that's my spiel.
Oh, I'm sorry. So Jason, we do have a question for you. Okay. In regards to Final Cut Pro.
Okay.
Do you teach Final Cut Pro?
I don't think the school has Final Cut Pro anymore in its curriculum or its, actually at the campus.
That's correct.
So what I can say is this, is two things. If you need guidance in Final Cut Pro, that's not something I can provide. I have experience with Premiere. Most of the time when I do work, the editor's working in Premiere, they give it to me, I work in Pro Tools or Ableton Live, and then I deliver the content back to the video editor who's working in Premiere. This class is mostly gonna be focused on the sound part. So technically speaking, somebody could do it without having to use video editing software at all. We are going to need access to some video editing software for some of the classes, but in terms of a project that somebody's doing or homework or the final project, what's really important, obviously, is the editing of sound. And placement and sync with visuals is an important part of the process and something we're going to talk about and understand. But again, that's actually somebody else's job regarding this class and how it fits into like the workforce.
So Jason, just to clarify, are you saying that like like the resources and the tools and the skills that you're learning in this course could be translated into Final Cut Pro?
Yes. Okay. Because again, it's like if you want to, if you have experience in any piece of software that allows you to do these things, then the ideas and philosophies and techniques that are covered in the class can be applied with lots of different tools. The point I was making is if somebody comes to class and is they're working exclusively in Final Cut Pro, I haven't looked at that for a number of years. And you know, if somebody had a question, as the teacher, I would like to think I can answer questions. And I just straight up, I don't think there's probably questions I couldn't answer about Final Cut Pro.
Thank you, Jason. And just to kind of echo what Jason's already mentioned is the school has really been focused more on Premiere Pro and DaVinci Resolve. Those are the two editing softwares that we've really focused on. So Final Cut Pro is something that we don't have integrated in our curriculum, but we will be, we're at least for my editing courses, which I'm going to talk about in a minute, we're being more lenient on software this go around, just because we're trying to teach you what tools you already have and know and use. Let me see if there are any other questions. I don't see any other questions. Anything else you want to add, Jason, before we switch over to the rest of the production courses?
I'm excited.
Me too.
I love teaching this class, and I'm so excited that it's come back. And I'm so excited, like I said, that the community college is emphasizing, hey, sound is important. You have to take this class because you have to know this. And maybe film festivals will become much more tolerable all across the land because people now know how to make things sound good. I guess one other thing I would say is, like I was talking about this, you know, the community college, we frequently discuss career path. You know, you can take these classes, you can get a job out of this. And that's kind of what my focus was. But another thing I always like to emphasize with my audio classes and film is that, you know, if you just heard me do my thing and then you're like, well, I'm a video editor, you know, I really don't know why I want to take this class. Because you are part of a chain, you're part of that pre-production, production, post-production chain. And if you're doing some work that is then going to be passed off to a sound editor, you really want to speak the same language and you really want to have an idea of what they do and how it best to prepare your work to give to them. And things like that, just speaking the same language makes all the difference in the world. And so I think it's a great reason for somebody who thinks of themselves as just a video person to take a sound design for film class.
Thank you so much, Jason. We are so so lucky to have you and to have this new Sound for Film course, or this old yet new course for film. I personally am really excited about it. And I think a lot of our students have been requesting that we have just a sound specific course. So yes. Thank you so much. I think that's it for the for the questions. Yeah. Thank you again.
Yeah. And I'm gonna turn off my camera, but I'll stick around if somebody comes up with another question. Just let me know.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. I'm gonna switch over and actually share my screen again with our schedule. So for the most part, most of our classes are gonna be starting August 24th, so that's next Monday or the week of. We do have some 8-week courses that are late starting courses as well, as you can see here, and those will be starting October 19th. So Cinematography 1, Advanced Grip, Film Crew 2, and Screenwriting 2 are all courses that will be starting October 19th. So those are the ones that won't be starting right away. Let me check. I'll see if there are any other questions. And then I'm gonna go ahead and start talking about some of the other post-production courses that we've been offering. So I'm Allison, and I will be teaching the post-production, the other post-production courses, Editing 1, Editing 2, which is Intermediate to Advanced Editing, and Intro to Motion Graphics. In addition, so for Editing 1, we actually have two instructors. There's myself and Jesse Walsh. So both courses are going to be online. My Editing 1 is going to be more self-paced. Right now it says Mondays 11:30 a.m. to 2:15 p.m. That's going to be an optional time for students to come in and check with me, like office hours where we can share work. And if I need to go over any tutorials, I will be doing that on occasion. But you won't be required to meet on Mondays at 11:30 a.m. to 2:15 p.m. So that one's going to be a little bit more self-paced, while Jesse's course, which is on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 5:30 p.m. to 7:15 p.m., will be more online, online conferences through Zoom or conferences on Canvas. So the Editing 1 course as well has also been through Quality Matters certification. So both of those courses should reflect best practices for online teaching as well. With the editing courses, as I've already talked about, we are going to be more lenient with the software. Before we were using Premiere Pro exclusively, and now we're adapting to that so that you can use DaVinci Resolve, Premiere Pro, Final Cut Pro. It's going to be more heavily focused on the concepts of editing and then the students showing mastery or competency of those concepts through their edits using whichever editing software they prefer to use. I personally have experience in Premiere Pro and DaVinci Resolve, so those are the two softwares that I feel most comfortable when answering your questions. The first part of Editing 1 is going to be somewhat theoretical, or is really going to be focused more on theory. I think it's really important for editors to have a really strong background in theory and understanding how to talk the talk, like Jason mentioned as well, being able to speak that same language. So that's what Editing 1 is going to be like. And then Advanced Editing is really a heavy project-based course. We also get into some advanced concepts like animation, and interactive content as well as VR and 360 video. Me personally, I have experience in editing as well as mobile app development and interactive content. So I love sharing that emerging technology with my students and really trying to push how we can really experiment with the concepts in editing. And then for the first time this semester, I'm gonna be teaching the Intro to Motion Graphics course. I am really excited about this. I love After Effects, and motion graphics will be centered just on After Effects. We're gonna be doing a lot of animation in that course, and we're also going to be doing trailers, title sequences, and a lot of fun animation for motion graphics. So that's gonna be, that course is going to be somewhat different than it usually has been in the past. Because of my post-production background, the motion graphics is going to be slightly reframed to film and post-production practices. Working with Premiere Pro, working with Photoshop. So that's what the motion graphics course is going to look like. Let me go back to editing too. That one will also be using the Adobe Creative Suite with Adobe Audition, Adobe After Effects, Photoshop, and Premiere Pro. Again, with the editing courses, we're being a little bit more lenient with the software, but a lot of my tutorials and instruction is going to be based mostly in Premiere Pro and the Adobe Creative Cloud. Let me see if there are any other questions, and then we're going to move on to our equipment that students will be able to check out and the new updated checkout policies and procedures. Let me just check over here and see if we have any other questions. Okay. Yeah, classes begin next Monday, August 24th, some late starting classes, October 19th. Okay, so we're gonna start talking about equipment. And let me go ahead and share. Oops, see if I can. Sorry, trying to start my slideshow. There we go. So I'm going to ask Milton, Ashley, Zoe, whoever is available to help me out with some of the new checkout policies and procedures with the equipment. So we have this slideshow here. So with our courses, we do have the Canon C100 that will be available for checkout in production classes. That includes Documentary 1 and that's where I'm going to ask Milton to chime in and let me know what other courses can use the Canon C100.
Oh, at this point, the I think the other courses are, if I remember correctly, are the certainly video production too, but that's not until spring.
Okay.
Cinematography, if that becomes a component written into it, is also part of that equation. I think that might be it.
I think you're right. I think it's the cinematography class. I don't know if do you use that in Film Crew 1 at all?
The C100. We have in the past because the part of what they do in the lab component of Film Crew 1 is they actually do a short film that allows them to utilize the rudimentary skills that they've acquired in the lab, the setting up of lights and stands, et cetera, et cetera. And we have in the past used that camera, although it's not a requirement for that specific class.
Okay, and I apologize. I'm just being reminded that the C100s are for the advanced students. Mm-hmm. So a lot of those introductory level courses will not be using the Canon C100. So I take it back, the Documentary 1. We'll be using that. Documentary 1 will have a different set of equipment.
Okay, gotcha.
So C100 is for the advanced students with experience. And may be used for Cinematography 1, but I think for the most part, advanced students.
Mm-hmm.
The Sony X70, this is the one that's a great introductory camera. If you've never used a video camera before, it's a really nice entry level equipment. It will be used for video production for a lot of the introductory courses, such as Video Production 1, Documentary 1, and I'm assuming Film Crew 1 as well, Milton. That might be one of the cameras that's used. Oh, I think you're on mute.
my apologies, I was on mute indeed. that is correct. I would prefer that they do use these cameras, the Sony X70 or the Canon version of it for the Film Crew 1 is a much more user-friendly camera.
Okay, great. Yeah, these are great cameras to learn, you know, the basics of camera technology, white balancing, exposure, focus, all of those kinds of things. Oops, sorry, in the wrong. We also have these are new. I'm so excited about these, right? I believe we just got these in maybe last semester or the semester before. These are the three panel LED kits. As a documentarian, I usually prefer LEDs and things that are much more compact because we don't always have a traditional studio space to take up a lot of big lighting fixtures with that. But these are good LED kits. And what's really neat about them is that I'm gonna have you talk about this, Milton. The RGB component. Do you know about? Are you able to talk about that? Or
yeah, not really. I mean, that's so. It's actually not really. Not without muddling my way through it, as I am clearly muddling my way through it. So no.
I'm gonna ask our amazing film cage technicians to help us out here. So Zoe or Ashley, can you briefly explain these new lights, because these are the new ones, and I don't remember all the specs that come with it.
I think Ashley's monitoring the sound right now.
Oh, okay. So maybe Zoe. Let's see if we can.
And I'm not sure Zoe is still there.
Okay.
So we may want
to. Maybe we can. Maybe we can come back to that. Yeah. Maybe we can come back to that one. So we also have, these are ones that I've used in my documentary class. The Aperture Daylight Temp LED Kit. Again, nice and compact. And these have, you can plug them into power, but I believe they also are battery powered as well.
That is correct.
Again, helpful for mobile tech, yeah.
That is correct. And one of the advantages of the smaller lights, especially the LED lights, lighting packages, is the power consumption. Because you don't have to worry about blowing circuits when you're online, on set or on location of any kind. It's self-contained. They are a bit broad. I mean, they're a good, soft, just overall utility light. They're really a fantastic piece of equipment that we're lucky enough to have a lot of. And we really encourage the students to actually learn how to use them. So yeah, it's an amazing setup.
Yeah, and that comes with these. They come with a light box as well, so you can soften the light. And going back to the RGB question, so that actually has all the color, the entire color spectrum, but red, green, and blue, RGB. So that's where the other one, I'll go back to that, is the three panel kit that can really be used for color, lighting effects. You can have strobe lights. So some pretty cool advanced technology that again will be for the advanced students. And the LED kit as well will be for advanced students and I believe some documentary students as well as video production if needed.
Yeah.
I'm gonna let Milton talk about the dollies, but here's some beautiful photos, really.
I'm actually
really impressed
with
the doorway dolly. Did you take these photos, Milton?
I did not take these photos. I wish I had. I think Ashley took those. So we actually at this school, we are extremely fortunate to have industry standard gear. I mean, it is state of the art equipment. The Matthews dolly that you're looking at right on the screen is commonly known as a doorway dolly, creatively enough, because it's wide enough to fit through a door. And it's probably one of the best used pieces of equipment for any scale production, because A, they're extremely inexpensive to purchase, extremely inexpensive to rent, and they do just about anything that you could ever imagine. The one we have actually has track or adapters so that it actually goes on track, and we have all the dolly track that we could hope for. And that's one of the advantages of the taking the advanced grip class at the end of this, at the last 8 weeks, and also Film Crew One's lab, because they focus, the instructor TJ Jones focuses one entire day on the dollies and how and what dolly grips do. And their job is one of those jobs that if you are good at it, you will work the rest of your life and whenever you want. But if you mess up a shot, you won't work a day in your life, no matter what. So you really have to be great at what you do. But we also have what's called a Fisher dolly, which is industry standard. It is it is what they use on every major film set, even to this day. And the Film Crew One train lab component focuses just an introduction to it. The advanced grip training focuses a lot of attention on the dollies, on how to set up the track, how to set up everything that goes with it, the mechanics of it. It's a course that really gets you, if you're interested in being a dolly grip, this course is for you, and we have the equipment that allows you to learn it. And we encourage the students to actually learn how to use it.
Yeah, I mean, it looks like you need a license to operate that.
Well, just a good steep hill where you can get on it and ride.
I think I read one time during the filming of Rope that the camera operator, cinematographer, got their foot run over by the dolly, and Alfred Hitchcock required him to be silent the entire time and play through the pain because he didn't want to ruin his shots. So even if you're working with someone that is like Alfred Hitchcock, we can help you out with navigating the dolly.
Well, and one of the things we also teach is about safety and about the type of footwear to wear when you're actually running one of these systems, so that hopefully that would never happen. So.
Right. Yes, we will teach proper safety protocols. So we also have the RE Sky panels, and I'm going to let you talk about this, Milton, because I believe this is for advanced grip and film crew advanced courses.
Yes, this is advanced lighting. And we're lucky enough to have a lot. We recently acquired a lot of, industry standard lighting packages and grip packages. And the sky panels are used every day on set. And we have other lighting setups as well. But these are really remarkable pieces of equipment. And that's one of the biggest advancements that's taken place in lighting. Because lighting, since the dawn of filmmaking, has stayed basically the same. I mean, there's been some changes, but up until the advancement of the LED and similar setups, there hadn't been a big change. And now it's a game changer, because now you can actually light much more efficiently. You don't need these big power stations, big generators, as much as you did before. You still need to know the specifics of lighting, the theory of lighting. You need to know the aesthetics of lighting. But that's never going to change, but the mechanics of lighting has changed and is continuing to change, and we have that ability. We also have, I don't know if there's a still of it coming up, but we also have a DMX lighting system control board, which basically is a wireless system that allows you to control color temperature, even focusing of lights, the intensity of lighting from a control panel. And that's a job that is needed in the film industry, in the state specifically, because not very many people in the state know how to do that job. And to my mind, there is no other school that has this equipment and that can teach this equipment. The DMX system is, why that's so important is for two reasons. One is it reduces the size of the crew. It also speeds up the setup time, because you're not having to move an individual with a ladder to set up and change the color temperature by adding and subtracting gels. Which means you may need a ladder, you may need two support people to hold a ladder, a technician to actually change off that, and that all takes time. And if you save time on set, you save something more important, money on set. And so the DMX system also does one other thing, is especially in this time of COVID-19 and safe sets, it reduces the number of people that have to be on set at any given time. It also reduces the exposure to equipment having lighting specifically, lighting equipment specifically being touched and handled by too many people. So that makes a big difference. So the DMX system, wireless system, is really, it's a big advancement, and it's going to even be more sought after. And the operators, they generally have to bring them in from Los Angeles or New York, or in some cases Chicago, because very few people in New Mexico know how to use it. Well, now we are going to be able to teach it, and they will be able to learn how to use it. It's still up to them to get the jobs, but they will know how to do it.
That's a really good point, Milton. Great. Let's move. Oh, we did have a question if photography students are allowed to use this type of equipment. And at this time, no. We do not allow. It's just for our classes, for our film classes. Oh, and that's it. go ahead. So I do want to also let you know that we have some other new equipment that we've been getting in this semester. We got 10 new iPad Pros. I'm really excited about that. Like Milton said, it can be used for lighting. We also are installing software to help with editing, mobile editing, recording, video production as well. So I really think that with this new pandemic, we're really seeing a shift in more mobile filmmaking. using things like iPads and iPhones. So we are really lucky to have already purchased those before we knew of this pandemic, so that we can really respond to this new type of independent filmmaking. Milton, Ashley, or Zoe, let me know if there are any other pieces of equipment that we would like to share. I'm actually being reminded, and if Jonathan wants to speak about this, is that we do have a drone camera.
Well, we actually picked up two drones. They're wonderful systems. I've been working with Jonathan on a different project we've been using, because he actually happens to have the same one, and it is so fun. It is so cool. I mean, and one of the things that we're hoping to be able to do sooner than later is start offering a drone course that will allow students to actually learn how to use drones properly, the safety aspects of it. The interesting thing is about this campus, SFCC, the campus is actually located adjacent to the restricted airspace because of the 5-mile radius to the airport, and also the landing zone. It runs right over it skirts the edge of the campus. So here we have to be a little bit careful, but again, it's nothing that's we have to worry too much about, but it's actually good that we are, because it gets students used to thinking that way, because I mean, you just have to, as a drone operator, you have to know the responsibilities that you as the operator have. And so we're actually able to, once we implement this course, and again, I'd like to get it started, hopefully, I would like to get it started as soon as possible, but realistically, it'll be 2021, it'll be spring that we're able to really get it going. And it's it really, I think, will give students the chance to just learn it the right way. And I think that's a critical component. And also, just as a side note, drone operation is, I don't think there's one film or TV project, film or television show that's shot these days that do not have at least one drone and on set to get those really cool aerial shots, things that we normally would require helicopters. We can now do it with drones, and they are a active crew entity. And in fact, on most sets, as I understand, there's an operator and at least two spotters that go with it. So the drone, so they take it very seriously in the bigger productions. So anyway, that's pretty much it.
Thank you, Milton. I think that's really important to talk about the drone. Again, we're moving towards this practice of mobile filmmaking, and drones absolutely fit that. And in addition to that, we also have a 360 camera for VR, and we're integrating that into the curriculum as well. I'm trying to think if there are any other new pieces of equipment that we've got or that we got in. I'm not sure if Jason can speak to this, but I thought that we also got in some new audio equipment for the sound design for film course and for the recording, sound recording as well. Do you know anything about that, Jason?
Well, I don't. Not specifically for the sound design for film class, but we have a number of field recorders and field recorder packs, which can be very useful, obviously, for recording sound in all sorts of different situations. And I believe that we have some more that have been ordered, and I don't know where they are in terms of showing up. We did get some of those wonderful iPads for the film department. And I believe that there's a sound design app that has been installed or will be installed on the iPads. In terms of what do we have, what are we getting for the department for this particular class, I think the most exciting thing would be access to field recorders, which is something that students will have as part of this class.
Thank you, Jason. I'm going to see if there are any other questions about the equipment, and then maybe Milton, you can speak about the updated checkout policies and procedures.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that we're really focused on is, again, emerging technology and mobile filmmaking. So we're adapting to the changing circumstances and adapting and updating our curriculum constantly. Because film is something that is constantly constantly changing with the technology demands. So I'm going to switch it over to the checkout policies and procedures. I think many of you are going to be very happy about this. We've been asking for longer checkouts for quite some time, and now, due to COVID, you will have that. So we have at least a 2-week checkout period. I'll let you talk about that, Milton.
Yeah, thanks. That is one of the happy accidents, I suppose, that took place during this time. The policies have changed. We are still doing checkout. We are not letting people come into the campus or into the equipment room or even into the film department proper, unless they are actually here for a class, that is. All checkout is curbside. And so what that means is basically you make a reservation for the equipment you want, you make an appointment for pickup and of course, delivery of the equipment or checkout and check-in of the equipment that you have to adhere to. If you miss that appointment, then you have to reschedule it. You can't just show up anymore. And that's one of the downsides. But with the appointment-based checkout policies, and we did a beta test of it this summer on a very small level, and it worked pretty well. Now, again, that was only a few students, but it seemed to be okay. The curbside service, what I mean by that is you will drive to the loading dock and the equipment will be brought to you in your car. Now, if you stay in your car, technically you don't have to wear a mask, but personally, I think it's not a bad idea. But if you do get out of your car, yes, you do have to wear a mask. The equipment will be brought to you, placed in your trunk or properly given to you at that point. When you do return the equipment, and you still have to return the gear, you will have to, it'll be the same policy in reverse. You will basically do curbside, you will park in the loading dock area. We will, you will call the equipment cage and you'll know that number is at that point in time. And the equipment will be, a person will come out and take the equipment from you. They will be in proper safety attire and they will put the equipment in a safe room and it will not be put back into inventory until it has sat for at least 72 hours plus being sanitized properly. And then and only then will it be put back into inventory. And but luckily we have enough equipment that it shouldn't impact checkout or access to equipment at all. But if it does, we will have to cross that bridge, obviously. But at this point, I think it's all right. As I mentioned, the checkout times are appointment-based. It's checkout and check-in days are Wednesdays and Thursdays. The first day of checkout is going to be the week of September 2nd. And that's nothing new. We usually wait a week anyway. The reservations used to be that you had to have 24 hours notice. Not anymore. We need 48 hours notice for reservations, just because we need time to prep it. And we are also understaffed these days as well. So we just need the extra time. The location, if you're not familiar with where the loading dock is, and some may not be, it is actually in the north end of the campus, I believe, just across from the fitness center. We will have if it's not already up on our website, we will have a map showing exactly how to get to where it needs to be. Also a detailed breakdown of all the policies that have changed and updated schedules, et cetera, et cetera. One thing that we don't want students to do is clean the equipment themselves. Several reasons is because if you don't know how to clean the equipment and you try to, you may damage it, and that would be catastrophic. And the other one of the other reasons is that we want to have full quality control over that part of the equation. And if we so we have to take it very seriously. It's just because we have to take it very seriously. That's simple. Again, I believe the students actually will need to sign a policy agreement, which is normal procedure, and that will also be posted as well. There will be tutorials for students that need to learn how to use the equipment, and that we can do it. We basically will do it at your vehicle. So it would be curbside tutorials. That's something that is, we're still working a couple of the bugs out, but that's the best thing we could come up with at this point. We may change it. And if we do have to change it, we'll certainly let you guys know without a doubt. But that's the basics right there.
Thanks, Milton. We are, that's it for our first ever virtual open house film. Before we leave, because there is a little delay, I'm gonna allow extra time to see if there are any last minute questions. So if you do have any questions, please ask them now because we will be wrapping up. But again, thank everybody. Thank you, students, faculty, staff, filmmakers, for joining us today for this very unique version of an open house. I hope it's answered your questions and at least alleviated some concerns that you all had about the upcoming semester. I'm just really, again, impressed with our amazing faculty. You all have, and staff, you have no idea. Usually the summers are a break for us, and they have not been that. We have been really working hard, going through trainings, adapting our curriculum, doing whatever we can to make sure we respond to the current circumstances. So as you can see, we do have some courses coming up this semester that are going to be updated for that, and next semester as well. We have some new courses in emerging technology and film studies courses. So please stick around with us and join our amazing cohort of film students and filmmakers and start telling some stories. Does anybody else have anything they would like to add, Milton?
Yeah, just briefly, I just want to, hey, thank you so much for putting this together. This is like really cool. I mean, this is like super cool. my nerd self says, this is neat. Nobody gets what that word means anymore, so who cares? I'm old. I would like to put a bug in Ashley's ear that we do a lot more photography of the new tools and equipment that we have and post them regularly so that people get a really good idea as to what we have. And I will happily help doing that, because that those photos were great. And I think it's something that we can do, we should do. And I think people, I mean, if I were a student, I'd want to look at really cool photos of equipment.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, and yeah, just to piggyback off of what you're saying, Milton, you know, Ashley and Zoe have really been doing an amazing job. There was a lot that Ashley, who is our film technician, had to do to update policies for safety reasons, and also had to go through training herself. So she's really been working hard. She is so amazing and so freaking smart, because she adapted all of this like that. So we are so lucky to have such a strong team. I think that's it. I think we can all sign off. Thank you to everyone who participated today.